discussion with the brain science that's limited, with the circles and the graph that you had about how maybe 18 isn't even the right number. How, you know, we have with all the statutes, a juvenile is somebody under 18, but maybe that's not. I mean, I didn't grow up that much after 18, I can tell you that. I got clients that are 20. 20, 21, 22, who are used to stuff, but they have much more severe consequences, obviously. But is there any kind of JDIA or this type of information that can be used or in that gray area?
Yes, absolutely. It's a great question. The adolescent development science, depending what domain you're talking about, and it's then, when we talk about psychosocial development, the one about how kids react to other people, they care about their academic, the one that we consider maturity level, the social science research studies show that that doesn't fully develop in anybody until about 26 years of age. That's the normal progression. So if you've got clients that are in their early 20s that are exhibiting these kinds of behaviors, susceptibility to peer pressure, engaging in things, or being inappropriately inappropriately in court, laughing and doing things that the court is seen as disrespectful. All this can be looked at through a lens of psychosocial development, and that's the normal case. Now, it also comes with a dramatic history of a learning disability, some kind of emotional disability, some kind of health disability. That is all going to negatively impact the normal development, so they could further along in their milestones.
Has there been any state that's followed that science and have a program where people between 18 and 26?
Not that I know of, and the real problem I see in the country is a real lack of services for kids that are 19 and 20. Because they still need this development framework and any services they're getting, so probation and like that. And if that's not being taken into consideration, kids aren't benefiting from it. I still call them kids. None of us were matured until we roll out with 19. And so that is a huge problem. But the problem is because the divide is 18 and the adult court is not rehabilitative focused, neighborhood focused, public safety focused, that they're not often not services. And so I guess my advice to you as defenders is twofold. What we've seen happen a lot in jurisdictions where we're talking to kids on that gray area is courts are often amenable when you demonstrate their need to use juvenile court resources. If there's some way of financially making that happen, that's something that you're going to have to step into this. So I've worked with adults who are in their early 20s. I've got kids who normally would have gone to jail, sent to residential treatment facilities at the age of 19, to go through that program instead with a severe, you know, probation or suspended families up on their head. They fail out of it, they're going to go back to jail. But at least they get the start to go through the residential treatment program to see if they can be rehabilitated in the adult system. And so there are little creative ways we can start looking at, looking at what's available in our juvenile court system, whether through a JDAI or some other organization, and see if there's some way you can craft an alternative sentence option through a judge for those things. I would still argue that the science is good for all those issues of culpability and inclusion and sentencing and even elements. It's harder to say that a 19-year-old isn't as culpable, doesn't have mens rea when a 12-year-old is better to live with a damaged child or something like that. That might be something to consider. But there are definitely ways that use what we learn in developmental science in the adult system.
The other thing would be this. We charge out juveniles in DUIs in adult court. With DUIs in adult court. I've got a 15-year-old right now charged with an adult court with a DUI. And it's not an alcohol DUI, it's a DRE, under the influence of drug DUI. So he did a 4-hour DRE exam with a very skilled officer. And then they determined that he was under the influence of drugs. And is there any kind of resources in it, or your organization or others that you can think of as far as his brain, why it would have been acting the way that it was because of his age and how his interaction with the officer would have been different after 4 hours. And, you know, sitting at a table doing all these examinations, being at 15 compared to being 25 or 26, do you have any resources that's available or something like that?
I've actually never heard of anyone trying to see how one of those assessments, especially a drug assessment, is affected by normal developmental behavior or even abnormal developmental behavior. It's a fascinating question. I don't know that anyone has said. I think part of the problem that we see in a lot of these issues is there isn't a lot of studies on adolescent development and human justice. There's a good handful of them, but there's so much more that we need to know. There's so many little areas like that where we would love to have that information. We just don't fund it. Not we, I'm not science. Scientists don't fund it or direction on some of these things. But what I would suggest to you is to try to, if you have the ability to consult with an adolescent development expert, we can help you identify those people, and we can get those people to be copying the assessment protocol and whatever it is that the officer is supposed to be doing. An expert can say, this is like, they might be able to say in one day, but this is what happened, but they can say, I can understand likely the average child had a problem with this, and the average child had a problem with that. That's something we could help you.
Separate person.
Yeah. And the other thing I just said, I often just talk about regarding letters is kind of caution, is that just because they're another lawyer and they're working, it doesn't mean they're working. And so that's something to keep in mind, issues of confidentiality and state of interest. Often the goals may be the same, and as a defender, it's very useful when you can hold the guardian ad litem to your side and have two advocates for the same thing, but we have to be conscious not to be holding the ad litem side of the case, because we have a different case. Yeah.
Well, we all know that being a registered sex offender is, in most cases, a lifelong statement, but I'd like you to comment a little bit about the continuum of juvenile sex offenders, anywhere from some maybe absolutely fixated pedophiles all the way to people that are inappropriately curious along the lines of I'll show you mine and show me yours and maybe I'll carry you away from there. Because we have our juvenile sex cases truly do run the game.
Absolutely. And I'm not prepared with the actual studies to share with you, but generally the studies show that juvenile sex offenders are not predators. That those that are convicted of juvenile sex offenses are often opportunistic, or as we're talking a lot about it in our organization now, normative child curiosity is getting criminalized. Now, I'm not saying that the other child who didn't want to be touched shouldn't be touched, but the idea that kids explore is, under the science research, normal. And being able to contextualize that as not predatory behavior is important for us as defendants, and especially when you've got lifelong registration. The other issue that comes up a lot, I don't know if your laws are doing something or there are, but child pornography, you said, or Romeo and Juliet laws, where kids who are both minors and having sex are both prosecuted for that happens in a lot of jurisdictions. They're just arbitrary means to pass that juice. They don't have anything to do with what you're doing with kids or whatever. So there are two. We try to argue those in court as mitigation, and if there is some discretion whether someone gets a registration clause or not, that might be worth doing. Or you can work on policy change in your state. The law is changed by educating legislators about studies that show that juvenile sex offenders are generally not predatory, they're often most of them are not. So it's kind of registration, like penalty on the kids, is that necessary?
And the National Juvenile Sex Offender actually has a great publication called Raised on the Registry. And I have a few things that I think this is a good time to talk about. I would like to give a full back to put on.
Yeah, I want you to get the mics too, so we can.
Either on the defense listserv or some other way, there's a great NJDC publication called Raised on the Registry, and I can make that available to anyone. Well, they can. I have it in the PDF, and I can email it out.
It's actually basically
okay.
We promote
right.
It. That's fine. I didn't want to take that for it.
And there's great information in there, most of the studies. There's also a couple of state courts that have rules mandatory registration in the Constitution of Pennsylvania.
I can't remember all.
And I think there's one other. And the opinion is really well written. It also based on constitutional law. And I was able to give those decisions as well as the Raising the Registry information to the judge recently in a data room I had that was mandatory registration. Except as you know, if you get a suspended adjudication, because I can give you a court, you're only registrable during that period that you're on suspended adjudication. Well, luckily, I also had a marijuana charge, so I was able to successfully argue to the judge based on the information in those publications to him if I could get a suspended adjudication on the rape, where he said, your suspended adjudication lasts about 5 days, and then he put him on the cancer care information on marijuana. But the rules for probation of marijuana were sexually and they go to the treatment. It's really great. I mean, never had to register if it's based on the decision of that probation. So there is ways to use this green science to help.
And just as another defense tactic you may be aware of, when it does have the original, even if it does have the original in South Dakota, if the child is convicted of a potentially registered offense, one of the conversations you need to have with that child and his family is that if you move to another state, you may be required to register regardless of what happens. So that is something that kids are getting in trouble all over the country. Even they're not required to register in Virginia, but maybe West Virginia, they're going to adult jail. But ignorance the law. Any other questions or comments?
Did I hear you have immigration?
We spoke earlier, I could talk about it. There was a question about how does immigration, how can that play out in the juvenile court, and how does that work out? And I think whenever I have a child who may potentially be an illegal immigrant, I really think twice about that. Because if a child is undocumented, there's a lot of implications to how that is going to play out in this court. Most obviously, the beginning is the issue of detention. The family is afraid of being deported, and a family has other kids, other obligations. They may have to decide to give up on this child. It's not important. You're going to have real difficulties in getting this child in this detention, or getting this child into a proper placement to a family. And so, these are things you really cautious of. And depends on your jurisdiction and your prosecutors and your courts. Lots of jurisdictions, they don't consider themselves mandatory or individual courts. You can have a frank conversation with the prosecutor. But we do something else. This is the issue as well. Because there's no danger that happens. In other jurisdictions, I could never mention a word from the Bible, even if that his last name is in Spanish, because I don't want people to start calling things. And so you have to know your system is a little bit better, but immigration has severe problems. And there's a lot to do. That's the problem. Can I get my kid out? Can I get my kid in the right disposition program? But there are other issues that more you investigate immigration issues. There are special visas for kids who are now unaccompanied, who have no parent. Right? There are special visas or immigration. And I'm not an expert in immigration stuff, but you have a lot of resources on that stuff. And one thing we always say is if you are looking at an immigration issue, this is one of those expertise issues that you need to associate yourself with something to make sure you're provision. And it's one thing that's actually taking off in states like New Jersey and Tennessee, in their public immigration systems, they have dedicated immigration workers. Like many kids who get picked up in the system as an immigration issue, they call the head office, nationalism. I've got all these questions about how is it going to be able to associate. You might not have that here, but you have immigration lawyers that know how this is going to play out. There are certain issues about how much marijuana you had, whether it's deportable or whether it's leave or denying that re-entry. And so knowing what those levels of marijuana are may affect your negotiations with the I'll plead to it, we're going to plead to this summer in order to stave off the immigration. So these are things that completely affect all aspects of the work. My question is, often I ask kids or families right here, legal, you're not going to necessarily get it, to be honest with you, find something. So I always keep that in the back of my head anyway, because if this family is legal, whatever they're telling me, how is that going to happen? Any other questions? Yeah.
I'm just curious, particularly the school reporting and those kind of viral consequences, are those unique to South Dakota? Are there other states that will require those kind of things?
They're not really unique to South Dakota. There's, especially the school reporting issue, all across the country, privacy and juvenile records has been eroded. This in response really to the victims' right movement and having a lot of success. We as victims, we as communities, we don't know the names are. And there's a debate whether that's valid or not, especially for kids. But that's what's happening. in my jurisdiction alone, we used to have absolute confidential data on all of our records. What happened in juvenile courts and in juvenile court, no one knew about it. No one could find out about it. The only people that knew were police officers, the directors, and the judge. Nobody else could. About 5 years ago, our technology changed. And now, a good portion of felonies or crimes on people are reportable to schools, to communities. Knowing what those reward requirements are important because the stigma is attached with juvenile court and then how it affects all the other collateral consequences because if a school can know about it, then a landlord, employer, all these things are going to be that. If our goal is to provide rehabilitation for kids and to say, yeah, we get it, you are amenable to change, so let's meet you in a program and get you to change. But we put such a stigma on them that no matter what they do, they can't succeed in society and they get out. That's a problem. And whether it's a policy problem and something we need to address legislatively, or an education problem for judges, or a negotiation problem for them, my client can't lead to that charge. Because it's reportable. But this charge is fine. That's been completed in system. These are things that you take into consideration when thinking about it. But all consequences are deep and long. And they're different for state. There's some that are state based, there's some that are federal based. It's kind of investigating and finding out what are others. There is a website that talks about common collateral consequences in every state. It goes out and look at the common collateral consequences that you do know. I'm not sure if I'm part of some of the issues. So that's one way to learn a little bit about collateral consequences. And some of them aren't evident. You're learning about the new every day. There's credit bureau reporting. We just learned about that.
Studies.
talk about. And it gives insight into what the study was, how it was done, and what the findings were. The reason I didn't bring it today is because I do, we don't like to share it outside of our health and development lesson, because knowing the science, but not knowing how to argue the science, and not knowing how not to understand the science, can be dangerous. So I'll share that with you, but I'm going to give you that caveat so we can get this document to talk about science. It's never going to say that Johnny, who was socially, who was psychosocially immature at the time of his habit, all social science is about tendencies and average kids. Like that. So if you oversell the science and the judge actually reads the study or the prosecutor actually looks at the study, you're going to lose all your credibility. And so it's really being careful about how you use it. But even if you're not using it in court, having these studies, I guess, is really useful for you in your interaction and understanding what the kids are doing and why they're making the decisions with me. So I will share that document with you. I'll send that. But it will give some of the statistics about how do you know. What is this thing? What is this thing? What was this thing?